certainly didn't intend to preach tonight, but the Lord has different plans. And I pray for the Lord to speak and the Lord to use the words that I have tonight. As I was sitting there, I was thinking back years ago when I first started preaching. I went over to Union City, Tennessee, and there was Miss Duncan was her name, had a little bookstore over there. And she wanted every preacher to have a Scofield Study Bible. So I bought a Scofield Study Bible from her, and I'd go back to get other books, and she would say, don't worry about it paying me for these books. She says, don't worry about that. You just take them. If you're able to pay for them sometime, that'll be fine. And if you are not able to pay for them, that'll still be okay. Well, I remember one day I was in there talking with her, and she said, Brother Lynn, if there ever comes a time when you're preaching and you don't know what to say, you just brag on Jesus. And that's what I'm going to do tonight. I'm going to just brag on Jesus. But first, I'm going to get this microphone here that I had for Brother Willie. And, you know, I haven't given up on Brother Willie being here yet, so if he starts in that door there before I get started, I'm going to let him preach. But I'm sure there's some serious reason why Brother Willie's not here tonight. I wish I knew. I pray that the Lord will give him safety, or there's not something drastic wrong in his life. But I certainly want us to remember him tonight in our prayers. If you'll turn to John chapter 12 and verse 21. John chapter 12 and verse 21. We'll read some verses there. And John chapter 12 and verse 21. Let's begin reading with verse 16. John chapter 12 and verse 16. These things understand not his disciples at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him, and that they had done these things unto him. The people therefore that was with him, when he called Lazarus out of his grave, and raised him from the dead, bear record. For this cause the people also met him, for that they heard that he had done this miracle. The Pharisees therefore said unto themselves, or said among themselves, that is, perceive ye how ye prevail nothing? Behold, the world is gone after him. And there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. The same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and again Andrew and Philip tell Jesus. Well, just in passing here, Andrew was a people person, wasn't he? Andrew was always bringing people to Jesus. Every time you read about him in the Bible, he's always bringing somebody to Jesus. So here he assists the Greeks in seeing Jesus. And I want to take that little phrase there, Sir, we would see Jesus. And I want to help us tonight to see with our spiritual eyes every phase of the life of the Lord Jesus. First of all, we see him as the pre-incarnate Christ. Sometimes people try to tell us that Jesus was just a man, that he just came on the scene when he was born in Bethlehem. But Jesus Christ was from the beginning. You can't think back past the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Bible also says in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The word translated God there is the Hebrew word Elohim. It means God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Jesus was here from the very beginning and before the world began. The pre-incarnate Christ. He was in the heart and mind of God before the world began. The Bible says that he was crucified in the heart and mind of God before the world was created. The pre-incarnate Christ. So with our spiritual eyes tonight, we need to look at the pre-incarnate Christ. And not only the pre-incarnate Christ, but the virgin birth of Jesus. The virgin born Christ. Now, some would deny the virgin birth. We have some to even say that the virgin birth is not even important. But the virgin birth is important. The virgin birth is what the Bible teaches in the Old Testament, and it comes true in the New Testament. If Jesus was not virgin born, then he can't save anybody because he's born just like we are. Jesus Christ was virgin born. Mary was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and Jesus was virgin born. Not only should we see him as the incarnate Christ, not only should we see him as the virgin-born Christ, but we see him as the God-man. 100% God and 100% man. Not 50% man and 50% God, but 100% God and 100% man. The God-man. The Bible clearly tells us that he was a man, that he needed nutrition, that he needed hydration. He got tired. He got weary with the journey. You remember as he encountered the woman at the well. He sat there thus on the well because he was weary with the journey. His body was resting. But on the other hand, he was God. God incarnate. He was 100% God. The God-man. And not only that, but he was the perfect one. We see him as the perfect one. The Bible says that Jesus Christ was tempted as we are, yet without sin. He didn't know what sin was about as far as experiencing it himself. He was tempted, but he did not sin. You can't find a flaw in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, man will disappoint you. I will disappoint you. I will sin. You will sin. But the Lord Jesus Christ never sinned. He was perfect all the days of his life here on this earth. He was the perfect Son of God. And not only should we see him as the pre-incarnate Christ and the virgin-born Christ and the perfect Christ and the God-man, but we are to see him dying on the cross, dying at Calvary. I'll tell you, as Gypsy Smith said, he couldn't get over the wonder of it all. I can't get over the wonder of it all. And never can I understand, never can I come close to comprehending God's love for us in sending his only Son to die on the cross of Calvary for my sins. He died for me. The Bible says, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. If I'd been the only one here, he would have come and died for me, dying on the cross. He died a sacrificial death, a substitutional death, an intentional death, a willing death. I was talking to somebody not too long ago, and they said to me, do you believe in capital punishment? I said, I do, because the Bible teaches capital punishment. And then they went on to say, well, Jesus was a victim of capital punishment. I said, no, Jesus was not a victim of capital punishment, because Jesus died willingly on the cross. He could have called 10,000 angels. He died willingly, deliberately on the cross of Calvary to shed his blood for your sins and for my sins. The sacrificial suffering of Jesus on the cross. We need to see him as the one dying for our sins. And not only do we need to see him as the one dying on the cross, but we also to see him as the one that was buried. You see, when Jesus died on the cross, he took the sins of the whole world upon himself. He took your sins and he took my sins upon himself. And when he took my sins upon himself and your sins and the sins of the whole world, the Bible tells us that God the Father turned his back upon the Lord Jesus. And Jesus cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? I'll tell you the reason in the last book of the Bible. It tells us that God the Father is so holy and pure that he cannot look upon sin. And when Jesus Christ was dying on that cross, he was taking our sins. All the burden of our sins was on him. And God the Father turned his back upon him. And Jesus died on the cross alone with the burden of sin of the whole world upon himself. But not only that, but he was buried. And there's a significant thing about him being buried. Jesus was buried. He was buried away in that grave. Now why is the burial a part of the gospel. I'll tell you why. Because when Jesus died on that cross and took the burden of our sins were laid upon Him. He was buried, and when He did, He buried away our sins. And not only that, do we see Him as the crucified Lord, substitution of death, dying in our place, buried, carried our sins away. But what a glorious, glorious first Lord's Day morning it was when Jesus came out of that grave. I'll tell you, it's a blessing last night to hear that young man talk about that empty tomb and talk about the tomb of Jesus. I've never been to the Holy Land, and I've heard people say that they've been in the tomb where Jesus was laid, and they say that there's no bones of Jesus there. Well, I know there's no bones of Jesus there because on that first Lord's Day morning, He came out of that grave victorious over death, hell, and the grave. And I'll tell you, we serve a risen Savior, not a dead Savior, a risen Savior. He's alive today. And I'll tell you, the great evidence of Jesus Christ being alive in our hearts is Him being in our hearts. I know the historical fact that Jesus arose. In fact, historians tell us that the easiest attested to fact of history is the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'll tell you, if you're a born-again Christian, you know Christ is your Savior. You know He's alive because He lives in your heart. You walk with Him, talk with Him. He's alive today. Amen?
Amen.
He's alive. We serve a risen Savior. And not only do we serve a risen Savior, and we see Him as dying on the cross and buried and resurrected. But listen, we see Him as the ascended Christ. One of the great events in the book of Acts that I enjoy reading is after Jesus had resurrected from the grave, and He spent several days, and in fact 40 days, instructing the apostles as to the ministry that they were to continue to do. And one day He was walking out there and on the Mount of Olives and instructing those apostles, and all at once something happened. All at once, Jesus defied the laws of gravity and He ascended into glory. And those apostles stood there with open mouth amazement as they watched their Savior ascend into heaven. I would have too, wouldn't you? If I'd have been standing there when Jesus ascended, I'll tell you, my eyes would have bugged open too. My mouth would have flew open when I saw Jesus ascend into glory. I see Him as the ascended Savior. But those two messengers came from heaven, and you know it took two to affirm a truth during that time, so God knew that. He sent two messengers from heaven and told those apostles, "Why are you standing here gazing? This same Jesus that's taken up is going to come back in the same way." I see Him as the ascended Lord. I see Him as the ascended Savior who's sitting by the Heavenly Father, by God the Father, making intercession for me and making intercession for you. Isn't it wonderful we have a liaison, an intercessor? There's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, and He sits at the right hand of the Father. I don't know why that Satan has access to the very throne of God, but the Bible says he does. And listen, Satan is an accuser, and he's always accusing us. He's accusing us. I'm sure that many times he comes before the throne of God and says, "Look here, Lynn Walker, watch him down there. He's sinning. He doesn't deserve to be saved." But when he does, I have an advocate, don't I? I have an advocate. I have the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Lord Jesus said, "Look here at these scars. I paid the price for him. I died on the cross for him. I shed my blood for him. He's forgiven. His sins are under the blood of the Lord Jesus." I see Jesus as my intercessor.
Amen.
Sitting at the right hand of the Father. Then not only that, but I see him as our coming King. Our coming Lord. I love to think about the second coming of Christ. I love to think about the time when our Lord will come in glory. I love to think about the time when the dead in Christ will rise and we'll meet the Lord in the air. And it's going to happen like that, by the way. In 2 Thessalonians 4 or 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18, we have the outline of the rapture. The Bible teaches us that one day, it can happen any moment, by the way, because the coming of Jesus is imminent. The coming to Jesus could happen in the very next second. We might not get through this service before the Lord Jesus comes, because every prophecy pointing to the coming of Christ, that is the rapture of the saints, has already transpired. They're already over and done with. And we can look up. We can look for the Lord to come. And He may come. And when He comes in the air, He'll stop out there in the outer air, and the dead in Christ will rise. And then the Bible says that we which are alive and remain should be caught up together with them in the clouds. What a reunion day that's going to be. What a homecoming day that's going to be. We're approaching homecoming season, aren't we? But there's always somebody missing at the homecomings. But when Jesus comes and the rapture of the saints and we're taken out to be with Him, everybody will be there. We'll all be together. We'll be caught up together with them in the clouds. To meet the Lord in the air. The coming of our Savior. Now people can laugh at it. People can make fun of it. People can scorn the second coming of Jesus. And they can say, where is His coming? But let me remind you that they talked about 4,000 years, talked about His first coming before He came. And we've only been talking about it since He left, only about 2,000 years. But in the Old Testament, they talked 4,000 years about His first coming. But He is coming. And God's timetable is right in place. God is going to send His Son for the children of God. And we're going to enjoy heaven. In fact, I thought about talking about heaven tonight. One of the great chapters in the Bible to me is John chapter 14. The Bible teaches us in that great chapter about heaven. I was raised on a cotton farm. Most of you know that by now. And if you wasn't raised on a cotton farm, you didn't miss anything, by the way. But I was raised on a cotton farm. We chopped cotton and we picked cotton. We had 9-foot sacks, and if we were good pickers, my mother would sew 2 foot on the end of that 9 foot. So we'd have 11 or 12-foot sack. And we'd pick cotton. And we'd get out about the 5th day of May and to the 10th day of May, and we'd start chopping cotton. And we'd chop cotton until July, and then we'd start back to school. We went back to school for 2 months, and they let us out again, and we picked cotton for 6 to 8 weeks. In fact, in our house, we picked cotton until the cotton was all out. They could be in school if they wanted to, but Daddy said, we got to get this cotton out before you go back. And we used it miss a week or two before we got to go back. But as I think back those precious times, I was the youngest of 3 boys. And of course, I was the one that got to chop cotton. I couldn't drive a tractor. I was too young to drive a tractor, but I could chop cotton. I remember my dad would chop along, and he usually talked to me. And I know now why he talked to me all the time. So he'd keep me up with the others. You know, I would get behind if he kept me talking. But I remember those times when he would talk to me about the 14th chapter of John. He talked to me about his mother that went to heaven. 32 years old. He was 12 years old when she went to heaven. And he said, the Bible tells us, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Because in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. He would quote those passages to me. And he said, I've missed my mother. I was 12 years old. Oh, how I missed her, he said. But he said, one day, as I saw tears rolling down his cheeks, he said, one day, I'm going to be with her again. And on September the 24th, 1985, the angels came and escorted him into glory. And there he was with Mama Bonnie. He was there with her. He said, listen, son, there's heaven. God has prepared for us a place. And he said, the most important thing is to know that Jesus Christ is your Savior and Lord, so that you can go to heaven one day. Don't let anybody tell you that heaven is not real. Don't let anybody tell you that heaven is a place of a mythical place like the land of Oz. I'll tell you, heaven is a real place, like Lexington, Tennessee is a place. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. And when he comes, he's going to take us to that place, to that heavenly home. I was standing outside the church, my daddy's home church, at my grandmother's funeral. Mama Bonnie, my dad's mother, had gone to be with the Lord when dad was 12. My granddaddy married again. And Grandmother Walker was the only grandmother I knew. I didn't know she was my step-grandmother until I was grown. She treated us just the same. And we was at her funeral, and my daddy's brother was there. Uncle Glenn Longworth. I knew Uncle Glenn had lived a dissipated life, a life away from God. I knew that as I grew up around him. But then in later years, he'd given his life to the Lord. I didn't know that. And I said to him, as we stood outside, I said, Uncle Glenn, have you ever received Christ into your life? Are you a Christian? Are you saved? Do you know the Lord? And here's what he did. He started weeping. And he said, oh yes. Says, I'm a Christian. Says, Bonnie, that's my daddy's mother that went to heaven at age 32. He said, Bonnie, led me to the Lord in the altar of the old church that was destroyed by tornado. He said, she led me to the Lord. And then I knew for sure that she's in heaven. I knew for sure that dad was with her because she was a soul winner. She led me to the Lord. Heaven's a real place. And I'll tell you, the older you get, the more precious heaven becomes to you. The most important thing tonight is, do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? How do you see him? Do you see him as your Savior? Do you see him as your Lord? Do you see him as your coming King? How do you view the Lord Jesus tonight? Let's stand up. Heads are bowed. Our eyes are closed. I don't know how the Lord spoke in your heart tonight. I don't know. If God has spoken in your heart, you need to come tonight. You have a need in your life as a Christian. As Brother Mark talked about last night, do you need to come and give something up in your life that's holding you back? You want to give all the keys to the Lord. Let him have total, total reign over your life. Let me ask you, how do you stand before God? How do you feel right now? If Jesus were to come and he could come at any moment, how would it be with you tonight? Lost friend, what about you? You know Jesus. You put your trust and your faith in him. Do you know the Savior? Just sing the invitation. Our heads are bowed. Our eyes are closed. You need to do business with God. Come over this altar right now.
Oh, to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give.
Open your eyes to the world, daughter. Open your eyes. The This world is much more than the things that surround you. You must arise and open your eyes. Sometimes we're too busy to share, but Jesus wants us to care, to care. Open your arms to the naked and shivering. Open your arms, open your arms. We need a little less taking, a whole lot more giving. We're so safe and warm, we can open our arms and love a little bit stronger. Jesus loves all men the same.